What's up, guys? It's your favorite QB coach. Welcome back to another video. Now, one of you guys wanted me to do a comparison video of Sean Foley versus David Ledbetter and then versus Calvin Miahira. Basically, comparison between these three golf instructors, talking about their theories and then seeing which one could be potentially better. That being said, this is what we're going to be doing in this video. However, we're going to turn it into a video series, and then we're going to do four videos in total. The first video, we're going to be taking a look at Sean Foley, kind of doing a little bit of a deep dive, taking a look at his theories, talking about everything you need to know about Sean Foley. So let's go do this thing. So before doing research, my first initial thought of Sean Foley was that he was Tiger Woods' golf coach and Justin Rose's golf coach. That's pretty much all I thought about him. I didn't really think about his theories, what he taught. I didn't really research him hardly at all before. So now that I've actually done some research about him, I'm hoping that this video will give you guys a lot more insight. And the first place I want to start is actually when he was a teenager. So Sean Foley, different from a lot of other golf instructors, was he wanted to be a golf instructor when he was a teenager, which I know me personally, I wanted to still be a professional golfer. And I'm sure a lot of other instructors were also trying to be professional golfers at that time. Now, the more research you do about Sean Foley, it makes a lot more sense on why he wanted to be a golf instructor when he was 14 years old. In this article from Golf Week, he talks about having idols like Gandhi, Malcolm X, Nelson Mandela. As well, in this article, he also talks about how he had just recently cried a couple days ago as well. So this article from Golf Week, which I'll probably link down below so you guys can also read it, will give you a pretty good insight of Sean Foley's character, as well as just to get to know him as a person. And I think that everyone who does want to learn more about Sean Foley or who does criticize Sean Foley should probably read this article, because I think that is probably going to change a lot of your opinions about him. So moving into Sean Foley's golf instructional theories, one of the people that he quotes as being the most inspirational to Sean Foley's golf instruction theory is going to be his friend Craig Davies, who's a chiropractor. Now, this just goes to show us that Sean Foley, at a very early age, was already worrying about kind of the science of the golf swing, specifically in this case, biomechanics, and how he can actually use that information from another field, infuse it into the golf swing, which at that time was not being done by a lot of people, and kind of come up with this new type of golf swing or this new type of theory that was a lot different than what normal golf instructors were teaching. And if you think about that, that pretty much explains Sean Foley's theories. He's taking all of these outside fields that are not necessarily related to golf, and he's trying to take all this experience, extract whatever he wants to extract from that that he feels like is applicable to what he's trying to do, and then he kind of infuses it into this end product that he's giving out to his golf professionals as well as his students and clients. So let's give you guys a real world example of this, and it's going to be Danny Willett. When he won the 2016 Masters Championship, he saw a steep decline in his play and dropping all the way to 276th place. Now, at that time, when he was at his low in his career, he actually went and found Sean Foley. And a lot of what him and Sean Foley worked on at first was more so about his mentality of where he is as a person, as well as just his personal life, and more so going into psychology as opposed to golf instruction. Now, personally, I think this was a great approach for Danny Willett, and I can also attest to this working for myself with my professional golfers. I live here in Japan currently, and I teach a lot of young Japanese golf professionals. And if you know the Japanese or even just the Asian culture, you know that when they're in their teenage years, that is the time that their parents want them to work the hardest, because that is the time where all the opportunities are to be had. However, what ends up happening is a lot of these guys who are 22 years old, 25 years old, know nothing but golf and never really had a personal life and haven't really developed as a person outside of just professional golf. So I actually do spend lots of times in my lessons, yes, working on swing mechanics and trying to get them better, but also just kind of being more so as a mentor or more so as a friend, someone that they can kind of come to with maybe some outside things that is not necessarily related to golf. Maybe I can help them with my personal experience and try to get them a little bit more cultured as a person. So bringing it back to Danny Willett and Sean Foley, I'm sure they did something very similar to what I'm doing with my professionals. They've built up enough trust in the relationship to where Danny Willett feels comfortable bringing up maybe things that are a little bit not necessarily related to golf, but he can look at Sean Foley more so as a mentor who has a little bit more experience in certain things, to where Sean Foley can then go ahead and maybe give him some tips or at least give him a plan of action of where to start to get down the road of getting better at whatever he needs to get better. So we're going to stop with the mumbo jumbo feely stuff and let's go jump into the science of the golf swing. Specifically, I want to talk about TrackMan and his time with Justin Rose. So if you guys don't know, Sean Foley taught Justin Rose really up until recently before the coronavirus pandemic, and he took Justin Rose from being a kind of an average player all the way up to world number one. And a lot of it, I think, can be accredited to their work with TrackMan. So what you guys got to understand at this time is that TrackMan was in its infancy in terms of popularity on the PGA Tour. So when Sean Foley and Justin Rose spent a lot of time with TrackMan, not necessarily changing the looks of his golf swing, but more so changing the numbers of his golf swing, they were getting a lot of criticism. However, I'm very glad that they did it. I'm sure that Justin Rose was very glad that they did it because it really catapulted Justin Rose up to that world number one ranking. And you saw that Justin Rose's ball striking began exponentially better. So one of the theories that I'm sure they leveraged with Justin Rose is going to be that the driver swing and the iron swing are going to be very different if you're trying to hit the same amount and the same type of curvature. Let me kind of explain. So let's say that you're trying to hit a push draw with both your irons and your driver, and you're going to try to have the same amount of curvature. So with the driver, you're actually going to need to have a 2-to-1 face to path ratio, which just means if you have a club path of positive 6, you're going to need to have a face angle of positive 3 for you to get a certain amount of curvature. Now, if you want to have that same amount of curvature with an iron, you're actually going to need maybe closer to a 3-to-1, maybe even a 4-to-1 ratio for you to get that same amount of curvature. Let me give an example. Let's say you had a 7-iron, you have that same positive 6 club path. Well, now you actually might need a positive 2 face angle to get the exact same amount of curvature as you are with your driver. So why is this so important for, let's say, a Justin Rose? Well, let's say he's trying to get the same amount of curvature with a driver as he is with an iron. If he had had the same face to path ratio with both of those, he'd get different amount of curvatures and he'd be confused and he'd probably try to change something in his golf swing, maybe even trying to change everything about his golf swing to be able to try to change that. When in turn, all he had to change was just his face angle, just a tiny bit, and he would actually have gotten the goal that he wanted to get. And that is why ball flight laws can be so powerful. You can actually change your curvature or change your trajectory or really change anything with not really changing your whole golf swing, which is maybe changing a little tiny thing here and there. So let's talk about another theory that I'm sure Sean Foley and Justin Rose leveraged to make Justin Rose a lot better ball striker. And that theory is gonna be how angle of attack affects club path. Let me explain with an example. Let's say you're hitting 4 degrees down with a 7-iron, and let's say that your swing direction is actually -2 degrees to the left. If you guys don't know what swing direction is, it's when it's measured at low point and the direction that you're swinging. So typically with irons, if you're hitting down on the ball, your low point is ahead of the golf ball. So at that point, that is when they're measuring where your swing is swinging towards. And if it's -2, that would be a -2 swing direction. In that particular situation, you would actually still have a club path to the right. Now, also, it depends on swing plane. I don't want to get too complex, but most likely your club path would actually still be to the right. However, on a 2D analysis camera, it might look like you're actually swinging out to in. However, you do still have a positive club path because of that angle attack. Now, if you have your face angle left of that club path, but right of the target line, you would actually be hitting a push draw, again, even though your swing direction is to the left. Now, let's say you keep that same swing direction. However, you change the low point behind the golf ball now, and you actually hit up on the golf ball 3 degrees, hence you're hitting a driver. What you're gonna find now is your club path is gonna shift from being positive, and now it's gonna shift all the way to being negative. And if you keep your face angle in the same spot that you did your irons, your face angle is now gonna be right of your club path, which means the golf ball is now gonna curve off to the right. And that is exactly how amateur golfers out there can hit a draw with their irons, but then slice their driver. They're not changing their swing direction when they're changing their angle of attack and low point. And if you don't do that, and if you don't know that, you're gonna get different curvatures than you want, and you gotta leverage that and you gotta understand that. I'm sure that Sean Foley and Justin Rose do leverage that, and that's why Justin Rose is a lot more educated than the typical golfer out there, and that's why he became a much better ball striker. So I know I got a little preachy there with TrackMan and gave you guys a lot of information. However, the reason why I'm doing this again is because I feel like it's very relevant to what Sean Foley would be teaching his clients, and I feel like you guys can get maybe a little bit of an understanding of what a lesson with Sean Foley would probably look, hear, and sound like. Because again, I'm sure, because I've seen interviews where he does talk about this stuff, that he does teach it to his clients, even as PGA Tour players. So moving on from here, Sean Foley, yes, he uses a lot of technology in his lessons and he extrapolates that information. And I'm sure for his average clients, he's kind of simplifying it for them. And then their PGA Tour players, depending on the type of player, I'm sure he maybe goes in a lot more detail. So I don't want to go into every single technology because this would be a much longer video than it needs to be. However, I think you guys are getting the point now that Sean Foley's main golf theories is based around science. It's not just his personal opinion, which I'm sure he does have some of his opinion put into it. It's more so based around what's actually real in the science. So I'm gonna end this video off here. Now, I'm gonna be doing the last video in this series where I talk about Sean Foley versus Kelvin Mihira and then versus David Ledbetter, giving you guys kind of a comparison of each. However, again, this video was just really going and deep diving into Sean Foley. So that being said, make sure, like, comment, subscribe, share, all that good stuff. I'll see you guys in the next video, which is going to be David Ledbetter.